Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing.
Amazing grace. It is so sweet. The name of Jesus. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we come before you this morning as we prepare for this morning's message. God, we just pray you move on our hearts. And Father, we love to worship you. It is a joy to worship you. So Father, allow us to express our love for you throughout the week, Father. Be filled with joy and filled with worship all throughout the week. And Father, we pray that you'd move on our hearts this morning. Father, as we dig into your word, that you grow us, change us, transform us. Lord, help us to not just be hearers, but to be doers, Lord. Help us to live for you as we walk out these doors. Maybe we be empowered by the Holy Spirit to live for you. Convict us, Lord. Call us out. Your word gives us truth. May we live by your truth. Amen. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and pull out 1 Peter. We're in 1 Peter. We're in a series, 1 Peter. We made it through about half the book. We're in chapter 2, okay? We're making our way through chapter 2, and we're going to be in verse 13 today. And we talked a little bit about this last week, that Peter's just about to address three difficult relationships. And those are, you know, when you have a believer is under the authority of an unjust ruler, when we're under the control of an unjust master, and also when we're being married to an imperfect person. And I got to tell you, I'm just going to be honest with you, I was tempted just to skip this section, okay? You kind of, once in a while, get there, and you're like, oh boy, you know, here we go, and this is going to be a tough one, and here we kind of dive into this. But I got to tell you, that first and third relationship, I think, is pretty relevant to us. You being under an unjust leader, unjust ruler, or those people in authority, how do we, you know, still submit to them? And then if you've ever been married, you know what it's like to be married to an imperfect person, right? My wife is shouting amen, you know, so that's what it's, so we're going to dive into these relationships, and we're going to look at two of them today, and look at one of them next week as well, as we're kind of diving into this, because these three relationships are just examples of one primary principle, one single principle that Peter's trying to drill home. And And that's that Christians, one of our major callings in life is to be patient and to endure in the face of unjust suffering. Because that's what's going to happen. There's going to be a season where it's just not fair. It's just not right. You're going to be treated unfairly. And how do we endure during that time? How do we still be patient? You know, and that's what he's going to say we need to look at and examine. And so Peter uses this word, and verse 13 begins with submit. And he's going to use that word in submission, and a lot of times we think, oh, you know what, that's something just the ladies need to learn about, right? No, that's not right. That's not correct. Friend, that's, you know, submission is a part of the Christian life. It's an important part of every Christian life. Yes, we're to be growing in God's word and have wisdom from the Lord and have confidence in the Lord, but also we're to humble ourselves. We're to surrender ourselves. We're to submit to the Lord Jesus, and that's what he's looking at. So Peter's going to use these three relationships to point out that we are to be submitting to Christ, and Christ is to be our ultimate example. I mentioned this last week. I'm going to mention it briefly this week in case you didn't write this down, if you want to take some notes. When we face unjust suffering, okay, Peter addresses this in this passage. How do we do it? We do it by looking to the example of Christ. We talked about the word they used in Greek. In order to teach their kids how to write in Greek, they would write out the Greek, they'd put a thin piece of paper over it, and then they would tell the kids, trace it. So that's how they would learn to write Greek, the language appropriately. So now we want to face suffering, we look to the example of Christ. This is what it says in verse 21 of chapter 2. For you were called to this, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He did not commit sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. That comes from Isaiah 53. And when he was insulted, he did not insult in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that having died to sin, we might live to righteousness. By his wounds, we have been healed. And that's from Isaiah 53. So as we look at the example of Christ, as we face suffering, unjust suffering, what do we do? Point number one was to be patient. Christ was in verse 22. He was patient, right? He knew that, you know, sometimes Christians, we think if I follow Christ and I do what he says, then it's all going to be good. There should be no bumps in the road. Everything should be smooth sailing. That's just not true, friend. It wasn't true for Christ, right? You know, he came in on a donkey and went out on the cross. All right? This was not fair. This was not right. This was not just. But that's how he was patient, even enduring that suffering. And number two is also that he entrusted those issues, those things, over to the judge who will judge justly, our Heavenly Father. And he knew that sometimes we keep waiting for earthly justice. I want to see it with my eyes. I want to see them get what they're supposed to get. You know, we kind of say, I want to see that. But that's not what happens sometimes. Sometimes we have to trust that and wait for that justice with our Heavenly Father in heaven. And the third thing is Jesus kept doing good. As he's being persecuted, as he's being ridiculed, being made fun of, he kept loving, he kept caring, he kept forgiving, he kept on doing what God had called him to do. And so that's what we do as well in the midst of that unjust suffering. And finally, by his wounds, we are saved. By the wounds of Jesus Christ. And so he bought our salvation on the cross. That's how we face this injustice, because injustice will come. It won't be fair always. But we're going to look at two areas, two relationships. The first relationship, if you want to take notes, he says, to the emperor and to every human authority. To the emperor, here we go, verse 13. It says, submit to every human authority. Every human authority, every human authority. Anyone who has a rightful authority over you. And says this, why do we do it? Because of the Lord. You respond first and foremost to him. Okay, not to the person, but to the him who is Lord over all of us. Whether it says in the verse 13, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority, or verse 14, or to governors as those who sent by him to punish those who do what is evil and praise those who do what is good. So people in the office can be fallible, can be messed up, can make poor choices. But the thing is, we still respect the office, that God has appointed a structure and an order, and we still respect that office. And so that's what we do so. And then it says, not as in verse 15, for it is God's will that you silence those that are ignorant and foolish by doing good. Verse 16, submit as free people. You don't submit because someone's better than you or they own you or lordship over you. You submit as free because we know the only authority, the only real authority is God himself. Amen? So, here we go. And not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but as God's slave. Honor everyone. Love your brother and sister. Fear God and honor the emperor. Okay, so here's the big question. How do we submit to a government leader that's, you know, maybe we don't agree with their beliefs or their, you know, their policies or we disagree with them? Well, first of all, I got to tell you, I don't think Peter, if he was free during that time, would have voted for any of the Caesars that he had as well. Okay? He wrote this around 60 AD. The person he was talking about in charge of that time was Nero. The people leading up to him, not very good. Let me tell you, Caligula, that was the first Caesar. Okay, here we go. He was not very fit to even run, you know, the country. Shortly after becoming Caesar, he killed his mom and his brother because he didn't want them to accuse or come against challenge his rights to the throne. He also took advantage of relationships with his sisters. He frequently cross-dressed. He went out in public like that. He installed actually his favorite horse into the Roman government. He put him in a place as a senator. And then he was doing such a good job when he voted down everything with a nay, you know. And so when he voted everything down, he actually promoted him to become a part of the council. I don't know what kind of horse you got to be to get promoted, but that's pretty amazing, you know. So Caligula was actually so mad one time at the weather, the god of weather, that he went out and said, hey, told those Roman soldiers, whip the waves. He went out in the ocean, they had to whip the water, and then he collected all the seashores up, and he said, the seashells, and he said, hey, now we've plundered you, we've taken what's valuable to you, and so he got the weather back, you know, so it's just crazy. He removed the statues of all the gods, he cut off their heads and put his own head on there. I mean, it was pretty intense stuff, you know. I may not have gotten your vote. So then next up was, Claudius. Claudius was, you know, handed over the reins. He was pretty cruel himself. And then it was handed over to Nero. And by the way, when I say handed over, Nero's mom came and killed Claudius in his sleep so that her son could become Caesar. Okay? So then we get to Nero, and Nero is the worst of the worst. I mean, he literally hated Christians all the time. He set fires in Rome, and then he sat back on his balcony and had music playing, and it was like poetic, and then he blamed it all on the Christians and had them brought in and fed to lions. Okay, so that's the emperor that Peter's talking about here. Submit to every authority and honor the emperor. Whew, really? That's a hard one. But Peter tells us four things about how to submit to those in authority, to those rulers. I'm going to give you four things if you want to write this down. Number one is that we always respect and honor, with respect and honor. Even when we don't disagree with them, even when we dislike them, okay, we can respect the office that God has given to them. There's a structure been put in place, and we can respect that place of authority. And so Peter was, if he was on Facebook, he was not probably always putting hashtag not my emperor, you know. He wasn't always probably putting that, you know. He was probably, you know, trying to walk this balance, and we'll talk about this balance. It's a difficult balance. Another way that he submitted to the authorities is one that was free. Free men and women. That's point number two. In verse 16, you will see that. You know, and we don't do that because they're superior to us. We don't do that because they own us. You know, as Christians, we know that our authority and the control is to no one but God and God alone, all right? We know that. But we still can submit ourselves to the authority for His glory, for His name's sake, in the name of Christ. It says in verse 15, it says, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but as God's slaves. For it is God's will that you silence the ignorance of foolish people by doing good. So we continue to serve as free men and women. And the third point is this. We also do it by submitting to authority, but we also do it in a way where we never disobey the commands of God. Okay? The word of God always is lifted up and always supersedes, okay? So if a government, you know, one day tells us that, hey, you cannot tell and preach anymore that, you know, salvation comes through Jesus and Jesus alone, friend, we're not going to be listening to that, okay? We will not be giving into that. God's word has to be lifted up. We have to listen to God's word. He talks about the sanctity of marriage and the sanctity of, you know, life. We have to speak up, even regardless of what the government says about that. So we can respect the position of authority and the place, the office of position, but we have to always still obey God's commands. That's period, plain, end of story. And the fourth one is we honor their emperor, even though sometimes we have to speak up against evil. We honor the emperor, but we also speak up against enter. I want you to know there's a list there. It says four things to honor. It says honor the emperor, and then in verse 17 it says love the brothers and sisters, fear God, and honor the emperor. Honor everyone. There's four commands. Honor the emperor was only one of them. So we have to love our brothers and sisters in Christ, and at times that means speaking up when they face injustice, okay? That's part of honoring them. So how do we honor the emperor and also love one another? That's a tough balance. It's a tough balance, but I've got to tell you, I've talked to Ralph over here. He has a book by Dr. King, okay? And there's the letters from Birmingham Jail, and it's a powerful letter. I would encourage all of you to read it. But he kind of deals with this. He kind of encourages us to balance this. He says, actually, he encouraged them to obey every law and only disobey unjust laws, and even though he encouraged them to peacefully obey that. Dr. King said this, he said, one has not only a legal but a moral responsibility to obey just laws. Conversely, one has a moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws. And then he explained, he says, the laws that lift up the sanctity of human life are just, and laws that degrade it are unjust. And so when he encouraged protesting, he encouraged peaceful protesting that was designed to create conversations that we could talk about these issues and talk about what God's word is saying in light of these issues of an unjust ruler. So honoring the emperor and speaking up for others, it's this tension that we live with. And let me tell you, if you live with this tension, here's how we're going to live, Christians. We're going to be odd at times. You know, because everybody really wants, people want to put us all in one side or the other. They want to say, are you all in here or are you all in here? Are you pro-emperor or are you all anti-emperor? And the thing is as Christians, we don't have an emperor, right? We live under the authority of Jesus Christ. And so we're not really a part of the tribe of the donkey or the elephant, but we're a part of the party of the lamb, amen? That's where we reside. That's our life. And so we got to lift up this balance. And so the question is, when you don't like someone that's in the office, are you able to criticize that which is ungodly? Or are you also able to, when you see something that is good and godly, are you able to praise that? And when you see someone that you like in office, are you able to praise the good? But also when they do something that's ungodly, are you able to criticize that? And people will say, wait a second, I can't figure out where they're at. And it's going to cause people to question. And I want you to know what that's going to do, we pray, is point people to Jesus. All right, that's what we're looking to. Jesus Christ is the ultimate example, and the ultimate authority is God's word. And friend, we have to live with this balance. And so I pray that our heart would supersede even our political affiliation. And it's okay to be political. We have an amazing mayor in this town, and we pray for him, and he does a great job. And we pray for our community as well, and those in leadership we pray for. But friends, we have to also realize that God may call some of you into politics, and that's a good thing. We need Christians in politics. But our point, our whole life desire is to point people to Jesus, to share the gospel. And I pray that that would be our primary purpose. And how do we do that? We look to the example of Christ. Those four things where we have patience and peace, you know, and we also, we look to his example. We stand up for the word of God. So that's kind of the example of looking at this first area, okay, this first relationship. How do we submit to those in authority? And we're going to quickly go over one more relationship, and that's earthly masters, an unjust earthly master, okay? Verse 18, if you have this in 1 Peter chapter 2, it says, household slaves, submit to your masters with all reverence, not only to the good and gentle ones, but also to the cruel. For it brings favor if, because of a consciousness of God, someone endures grief from suffering unjustly. For what credit is there when you do wrong and are beaten and you endure it? But when you do what is good and suffer, if you endure it, this brings favor with God. Okay, friends, you thought the first section was hard. Here we go again. This is another hard section. But I got to tell you, this passage has been used and twisted to say that Peter was actually in favor of supporting slavery. That is a complete misreading of this passage. Okay, first of all, I want to be real clear about slavery in Rome. Slavery in Rome was referring to a different slavery than we saw here in the U.S. It wasn't based upon ethnicity. It wasn't based upon one ethnicity being superior to another, which is completely not contrary to God's word. Okay, this was a Roman Empire. You became a slave one of two ways. One, you were conquered through war. Your village was conquered, and so you would become a slave. And two, you also had a massive debt. You wanted to get something or buy something. You had a massive debt that you couldn't pay off, and so you would become enslaved. And so a lot of the slaves would also look like Romans, okay? And they were, you know, they would also usually be let go by the age of 30. And probably around 60 million people were actually enslaved throughout the Roman Empire. Now, it was a time full of complete injustice as well. It wasn't pretty. Aristotle actually wrote about this and said, you know, no friendship can be given to an innate thing. And how can you be you be friends with a horse? You know, and he said, you cannot extend towards a slave the same friendship. A slave and a master, a slave have nothing in common. A slave is nothing but a living tool. And so I want you to know, neither Peter nor Scripture approve of any form of this kind of slavery, okay? Scripture strictly condemns it. Exodus 21:16, it says there, anyone who kidnaps another, sells him, must be put to death. 1 Timothy 1, Paul talks about slave traders in the exact same sentence with basically those who killed their parents, okay? So this was in the Old Testament, this was one of the few things they actually gave permission for the death penalty. Okay, so the entire gospel, friend, is contrary to the idea of slavery. Gospel teaches that all people are made in the image of God. and that we're united by a common problem. That common problem is sin, and we have a common hope, and that common hope is Jesus Christ, okay? And we are friends in Christ. We are all brothers and sisters in one family. And that's why he actually, Paul says at one point, he says, greet your friends with your brother with a holy kiss. So when you came into the church, even though a master and a slave may be right next to each other in the church, they were to greet each other with a holy kiss, saying, hey, we are brothers and sisters in the Lord. And that's how we are to be looking at and valuing one another as children and sons and daughters of God. So I want to get back to the main point. Peter's purpose in writing this is not to evaluate the current economic landscape. It's actually to encourage us to how to experience, when we're experiencing injustice, how to face that. That's why he's writing this. Why? Because at some point, friend, all of us will probably face an injustice at some point. And here's how we're called to respond, like Jesus. He gave us an example. We're called to respond like that. And some of you may be going through an injustice right now. It may be a hard season. And I got to tell you, maybe at work, you're in line for that promotion, and you got the degree that you're supposed to get, you had the experience that you're supposed to get, and they still skipped over you. That's just not fair. It's not right. It's an injustice. Maybe the legal system isn't working in your favor right now, and it's just an injustice that you're facing right now. Maybe you've had a spouse that's, you know, just not treating you well, and they've put out rumors and spread stuff against you, and it's painful. And friend, we're looking for that justice. Friend, we may not see that justice in this lifetime, but we have to trust it over to a Lord and a God who will bring about ultimate justice, and we'll see that one day. And that's how we face it. We face it by looking at it just like Jesus Christ, what we saw in 1 Peter verse 21 through 24 when he gives us that example. So I continually remind myself, as we all should, we've been talking about living as exiles, that we're not from this. This is not our home. We look to our heavenly home, friend. And so I want us to realize that we're going to look like strangers at times, as exiles, and that our ultimate justice will be entrusted to our heavenly Father in an eternal kingdom. So I want to close with a story. Maybe you probably know this story, but Eric Liddell, amazing, amazing Olympian, okay? There was many of you might have seen the movie about the Chariots of Fire. And Chariots of Fire was a powerful movie about how his religious convictions, his Christian convictions, kept him from running on Sundays, and that's what, you know, most of the story's about. But I got to tell you, there's a lot more of the story. He was a Scottish Olympian from the 1920s, and after in about 1925, he left to become a missionary. After he went in the Olympic gold, he left to become a missionary. He went to China. Okay? There, he knew God had called him to serve and share the gospel, and he loved on the people, was incredibly kind and giving and generous person. And there, the country was starting to be overtaken by the Japanese. London actually called them back. The British said, hey, if you're over there, you need to come back now because it's not safe. And he decided to stay and risk it all. He stayed there, and he said, these are my people. This is where God has called me. This is not my home. And so he put his citizenship there with the Lord Jesus. And so there in 1943, the Japanese overtook the Chinese city. He was put in a prison camp. And there it was very difficult. They actually had an opportunity. He spent his last 2 years of his life there in that prison camp. But he had the opportunity, actually, to be freed. They did a random selection. They said, you can actually go. But he actually gave up his spot for a pregnant woman and her son. And he stayed there, and he was actually shot to death in that prison camp. Why did he not go? Why did he not leave? Because, friend, he knew that England was not his home, that China was not his home. He was thinking of only one home, and that's his heavenly home, where he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. Friend, that's where we got to put our allegiance. That's where we got to put our hope. And that's where we got to even submit to those in authority when God calls us to. Because God says in verse 15, for it is by God's will that you silence the ignorance of foolish people by doing good. So friend, keep serving. Keep sharing the love of Jesus. Keep ministering. Keep being a light in this community so people can see the hope of Jesus. May that be our number one allegiance. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, thank you. Thank you for this morning and diving into your word, Father, and even on hard passages, Father. Help us to walk through them, Father, and Father, be true to you. And Father, we just pray that we would be true. Father, we think about, you know, where our hope is and where our vote is. And Father, that's very important. But Lord, most importantly, may we point people to you. May we stand up for the Word of God wherever it is. And that may be difficult and hard, and we may not look normal. We may look strange and odd, like we don't fit in, because we don't fit in here. This is not our home. We cannot wait for eternity with you. May we put, every one of us, put our faith and our trust in Jesus Christ. And may you be our allegiance. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's stand as we close in worship. So good to worship with you this morning. Thanks for being in worship this morning. And we're just praying God to bless you and give you a blessed week. Here's a blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Have a blessed week.